So I'm Hannah Bialyts, and I'm a neuroimmunology researcher at the University of Glasgow. And that's probably not an area of research I ever would have known existed back in school or even university. I really only discovered it when I ended up doing my master's here at the University of Glasgow. What I wish I'd been told when I was a teenager is that you're always figuring out what your calling is. And it's about experimenting and taking advantage of every opportunity you have and knowing you can do it. And knowing that it's all right if it's not perfect. If I went back in time and met myself when I was 12 and I saw what I'm doing now, I would be blown away and I'd be really excited. But I'd also probably say, hey, that is not what I said I wanted to do. I wanted to be an oncologist. Science is so big. Research is huge. Just give yourself the chance to try it out. And you may think that science is just maths, biology, chemistry. And if you think your brain's not built for that, you think you can't do it, but that's not true. Everyone observes information differently, and it doesn't mean you're not smart, and it doesn't mean you're not right for it. I did my undergraduate in biochemistry, and my least favorite thing to hear from people was, oh, you're a biochemist, you must be smart. Understanding the human body and understanding the basic science of the universe doesn't mean you're more intelligent than someone else who's doing something different. I don't think that being a scientist makes me smart, and I don't think I'm smart because I'm a scientist. I think I was smart to pick up on the fact that science is what I wanted to do early. Science is for everyone. And if you even have the smallest of interests in science, the big science, whatever that your little science may end up being, whether you become a neuroimmunologist or you want to become a doctor one day, or you want to be a marine biologist studying coral off the coast of Australia, whatever science is for you, just try it. See if you like it. And if you don't, try something else. See what you can do with science. And I wish you the best of luck.
For HERstory, I'm going to give you a whistle-stop tour of my 30 years to demonstrate that happiness does not always equal success. I spent my early years reading, drawing, exploring the outside, and even apparently creating my own species of finless dolphin, as shown so well here by my artwork. Moving on to teenage years, things were tough and I struggled with my mental health. I spent too much time doing things that I shouldn't have been, and not enough time focusing on the things that I loved, like reading or the outdoors. I passed through school though, and then headed on to Sheffield College, where through hard work and some fantastic teachers, I managed to get some of the highest marks in the country in some of my exams. But one of the reasons that I did so well is that I stuck my head in my books to distract myself from big heartbreak and some really tough things going on in my personal life. I headed off to university to study my dream topic, marine biology, but unfortunately the grey cloud continued over my freshers year and I ended up deciding I needed to take the cloud seriously and spend some time healing. I took a 2-year leave of absence, which to the outside world looked like a catastrophic failure. I worked in the local fruit shop, but it turns out that those 2 years were the making of me actually, and I completely rebuilt myself. I thrived and headed back off to university, where I managed to go on research trips to study killer whales in Canada, and I was so happy and so appreciative to be back studying what I loved that I won awards for and got the highest marks in the year. I graduated from St Andrews and then headed north to Aberdeen to do a master's in marine and fisheries ecology. The course was great, but I didn't enjoy my life in Aberdeen at all, so my happiness again took a dip. So learning my lessons from before about taking care of your happiness and taking care of yourself, I did a moonlight flit to a little fishing village, got a house by the sea, and I ended up getting my dream job taking pictures of dolphins. It was a fantastic few years, which has only improved further by me recently starting a PhD, where I get to spend all my time studying marine mammals. It's your happiness and your joy in what you do that's important. Make your happiness your priority and you'll be on the right track.
Hi, my name is Madeleine and I'm a master's student at the University of Glasgow. However, how I got here wasn't exactly conventional. At first, I thought I wanted to do business. And then I tried anthropology and finally I found genetics. All while I was a barista, a nanny, a waitress, and a Kendall attendant. But now I study whether there's a genetic link between obesity and mental illness in a very specific part of the genome, and I never thought I would have this opportunity to study something that affects multiple people worldwide. And I'll be honest, sometimes I have to take a step back and realize, I'm a freaking scientist. I did it. And I never thought I would. In school, I didn't think science was an option for me. In fact, I had someone tell me it would be too hard. And I'm so happy I didn't let that stop me. Because science has taught me some valuable lessons. And I'm not exactly talking about the Krebs cycle or mitosis and meiosis, even though it taught me that too. My favorite lesson was the one about change. It's everywhere. In math, sometimes they call it delta. In biology, sometimes we call it adaptation or mutation. But my point is that change is common. And as scientist, it can be a big part of what we do. How and why things change. What causes those changes? And it's about answering those questions to gain a better understanding for a better future. And for me, the best type of change is one of growth, or development, or progress, whatever you want to call it. It's about the new generation of scientists that can bring on that change. You can be the next scientist that helps us understand an old change or a new one. And new perspectives and backgrounds are necessary for science to truly progress, to grow. So no matter how unconventional your journey might be, you can end up making a difference.
Hello, my name is Anne. I'm 26 years old and I work as a researcher at the University of Aberdeen. Today, I'll show you what my colleagues and me work on. Safety first, so before starting to work, we put on our lab coats and safety specs and gloves. This is what our lab looks like. Here, all of us are microbiologists. This means that we study tiny living things. This could be bacteria or parasites. However, here in our lab we study fungi. Fungi? No, not that kind. The fungi that we study are pathogenic yeasts. Here I've grown them in a petri dish, and this is what they look like under the microscope. But why are they even interesting? Excellent question. Our fungi of interest are so-called candida species. They harmlessly live in the gut of about 50 to 70% of people. There, they are part of a healthy microbiota and are surrounded by mostly beneficial bacteria. Although Candida stays friendly most of the time, it can make people very sick when the right opportunities arise. This is why it is also called an opportunistic pathogen. For example, if a person's microbiota is out of balance because of severe antibiotic treatment, or their immune system isn't working well because of an organ transplantation, Candida can take advantage of this and cause an infection. When this happens, Candida can multiply and spread to the whole body. This can ultimately lead to death, if not treated in time and appropriately. Worldwide, more than 400,000 people get life-threatening infections every year, and depending on where on the planet the patient is, mortality ranges between 46 and 75%. This is a big problem, and my colleagues and me from the Von Homic Consortium across Europe are working together on a better understanding of the interaction between the fungus candida, the human host, and the microbiota. Together, we analyze the genomes of candida strains, the infection process, and how beneficial bacteria can stop candida infections. Hopefully, our research will lead to new treatment options and save lives in the future. I hope you enjoyed this quick overview of candida research. Thanks for swinging by and watching!
What's your favorite memory of playing outside as a child? My favorite memory is spending a lot of time with my family outdoors in nature, going camping and for walks into the woods, despite living in Berlin, a big urban city in Germany. As a teenager, I continued being active outdoors on a farm with horses and went on camping trips with friends. Did you know that our later life, health and well-being is influenced by the experiences we make as children and young people? My name is Anne Martin, and I want to tell you how I ended up researching how play and learning outdoors can influence the well-being of children, families, and entire communities. When people ask me as a child what I wanted to become when I grew up, I said I wanted to become a nursery teacher. Eventually, I followed my mom's footsteps and became a physiotherapist. As a physiotherapist, I did work with all sorts of people, young and old. but also made sure to work with children in nurseries as an exercise instructor. I then became interested in preventing diseases, and I decided to study nutritional sciences. Studying opened up the opportunity to move abroad, and I came to Scotland to study human nutrition, followed by my PhD, researching how young people with obesity get on in school. Couple of years after my PhD, I started combining my positive experiences of spending my childhood and teenage years outdoors in nature with my interest in preventing diseases and working with nurseries, young children, and their families. Now I'm researching how the many factors of healthy child development influence each other and what can be done to give young children the best start in life. I use methods from social science, system science, and public health science. I found out that only a few nurseries offer nature play opportunities for children so far. This is because of factors like access to and availability of nature space, adults' experiences of the outdoors as children, how outdoorsy adults are, teacher training, and funding. So if you follow your own interests and are not afraid of trying something new, you can become a public health researcher too.
Hello everyone, my name is Rachel and I'm a postgraduate researcher at the University of Strathclyde. My journey with science is a bit different. I never expected that I would end up in a science-based course or a science-based career for that matter. I always wanted to be a news anchor when I was a child, so much so that I would sit in front of my mom with old newspapers and read them out to her just to practice and up my skills. However, when I got into high school, I found that I thoroughly enjoyed the sciences, and in particular biology. I found it interesting how things work in the body and how different processes explain what happens in the body. Therefore, I knew that I wanted to do science from then on. So I chose a science-based course for my university, and I chose pharmacy because I also wanted to impact people's health aside from being interested in science. So I went into pharmacy, and that's where I discovered my passion for research from a research proposal that I did in my third year. And it was basically on nanotechnology and how this small, I can call them small particles or small robots work in the body, and they heal and basically diagnose diseases in the body. And I developed an interest in this new technology, that's nanotechnology. And after I finished my studies, I knew that I wanted to advance more and research more on this area for myself. So I chose to get into a PhD course, which is what I'm doing currently at the University of Strathclyde. And it's basically on nanotechnology in pancreatic cancer. So this is just for anyone thinking about doing a science course. It's very worth it. It's rewarding. You find out loads for yourself and you get to impact people by your wonderful research. So if you're planning on doing a research course, here is your answer to do it. Thank you. Bye.
Hi, my name is Meredith Schertzinger. I'm a PhD student at the University of St. Andrews, and I'm studying physical activity. Now let's go back in time to where my journey began. In undergraduate, I was a football player for my uni, until I had a career-ending knee injury. I was devastated, and I didn't know what to do. At the time, I was studying psychology, and I thought, what if I combined my love for sport with psychology? I received my master's in sport and exercise psychology at the University of Stirling. I enjoyed working with athletes, but through this program, I realized my passion was finding ways to help people be active, enjoy it, and stick with it. Because there are so many health benefits to being physically active. Physical activity is any form of movement that releases energy from your body, such as gardening, carrying groceries, and dancing. Exercise is physical activity that is planned in a structured or repetitive way. Exercise can be done alone or with others, and my PhD is looking to understand the varying forms of exercise. Of course, exercising alone, you receive the physical and mental health benefits. However, when exercising in a group, you may put in more physical effort, experience greater enjoyment, and are more likely to return. And there are mental health benefits to being part of a community. Therefore, when people are not routinely active, starting out with a group may be extremely helpful for someone to start and stick with exercise.
What is something you wish you knew when you were at school?
If there's something you're curious about, you can research it. The possibilities are endless. I had no idea growing up that I could study physical activity and sport. You are the next generation of scientists, so don't stop being curious and stay keen to follow your dreams.